So I'd like to pick up today where we left off yesterday. Presumably, though, you've closed our studio in the meantime, and you'll need to recreate the project. And also, I've made some changes to the code that we're working with and that we're going on to work with. So as a first step, I'd simply like you to reload your project as it is, because you might have made changes in the files, and I want to make sure, since I've uploaded new versions of the master script and some additional files, I want to make sure these changes don't get overwritten. So if you haven't made any changes in your files, ignore what comes next. If you have made changes, you open your file here, and your changed version of, say, REDA, dimension reduction, is somewhere. And now save this as something with a slightly different name. For example, save as dimension reduction my notes. So simply that you have a second and different version that's updated. And the next thing is probably, and I hope this works, I can't test this because my system is always updated, simply to say pull branches and see what happens then. That should update the script, and that should update the new files that have been added, and hopefully this is not going to delete your old files. So, what happened? If you look at your files, do you have a file called REDA Dimension Reduction Part 2? Okay, excellent. If you go into your file Task Solutions, does line 29 start with a more principled solution? Excellent. Does your file REDA Dimension Reduction MyNotes.R still exist? Excellent. Good. Okay. So I think we're in good shape to continue. Now, if I look at my environment, of course, none of my data files that I've created yesterday exist. So the first thing I need to do is to recreate them. In the script part 2, which contains all the code from part 1 that we haven't been working through, the first step is to recreate the data. Simply select that block and execute it. And after that, all the objects that we've been working with should be recreated. So I didn't think of this earlier, but if this is a script that you work on at home and that you frequently have to abandon, how would you avoid having to recreate data files? Right. So if you want to share these, you can save, you can basically, well, like in a video game, install save points from time to time, where you simply save what you've done so far and reload it. And then you can start off from that point and assume that everything previous has worked. Okay. Now, in your task solutions, I've put in a more principled solution to plot the crabs data from the principal components analysis with specific shapes, colors, and sizes. And I'll briefly go over how we can do this because it's a good view on the way the plot function works and can be customized. Okay, there's a question.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are getting errors because they're overwriting when they're pulling your newest version, that it's not allowing them to do it. So
even if they save as the file to something different, whenever they try to pull, it gives an error. Like if they change the source stash,
okay. So some of you get that, but not all of you?
No, because I have open saved project. My project was saved for a few years. So they didn't, the state of their project, their session is not saved. They need to save it first.
So you can simply reinstall the project, calling it day two, and that should have all the files. That should give you a current version. Okay. So maybe I'll just run through. There is one line missing here from part one, and you'll need to complete that in your version of the part two where we recreate the data. The line that's missing is to do the principal component on the CRABS data set on columns 4 to 8 and assign that to the variable PCA CRABS. So that should recreate all the data. Okay. So I've defined this function, and I'll just briefly show you what it does. List plots for me, blue males and females, and orange males and females, and with specific plotting symbols. And being able to do something like this, as I mentioned yesterday, is rather important to allow you to visually identify and find structure within your data. And to do this, we use the fact that the normal plot function for most of its variables accepts not just single values, but vectors. And if it gets a vector, it applies that vector to all the items that it takes in. So the plot function I call here is x and y, and I'm plotting the principal components PC2 on the x-axis and PC3 on the y-axis. And this has 200 rows. But now I'm also giving it a vector of 200 rows that contains, as a number, my plotting character. And I'm also giving it a vector of 200 characters that contains my colors. And I'm also giving it a vector of 200 integers that, or 200 numbers that define the size of the plotting symbol. And here's how the function does this. So the function has parameters x and y, species, sex, and age. So this is how I drive the function. When I actually run it, I say something like plot crabs, PCA crabs x2, which is my x, PCA crabs $x3, which is my y, crabs1, which is my species, crabs2, which is the crab's sex, and PCA $crabs1, which is a stand-in for the age. It is basically the variation along the first principal component. So you don't need to do this, but just as to illustrate it, I'll simply assign this to the variables x, y, species, so that I can illustrate for you how the internals of the function work. Then we have sex, and age. Okay, so species is a set of factors of blue and orange. Sex is a set of factors of males and females, and they're arranged in the way that we have them. Good. So what the function now does, it takes my species, sex, and age and converts that into something that I can use to define colors, shapes, and size of plotting characters. For my colors, at first I define simply the four colors that I want to use in a vector. Because what I want to do now is I want to take my vectors of factors, compute something with them, and use that to pick out the colors from my color set. So if I use my factors to compute a 2, I would like to pick out the second color. If I compute something to be 4, I would like to pick out the fourth color. And then all I need to do is to transform my factors, of which I have 2 different kinds, to give me numbers 1, 2, 3, and 4, corresponding to blue males and orange males and blue females and orange females in the way that they appear in my data set. So, as you've seen, species is a set of factors, B and O. But underlyingly, factors are coded actually as integers. So factors are stored as integers, and there's a table that says each of these integers corresponds to something. So the integer 1 corresponds to B, and the integer 2 corresponds to O. And this is the way that the factors are actually used. Underlyingly, they're just numbers, but the numbers have a particular meaning, and that particular meaning is remembered when the factor is defined. But when I convert these factors into integers, I get a list of 1s and 2s. And similarly, if I convert my factors in the sex vector into integers, I also get 1s and 2s. Now, all I need to do is to treat my 1s and 2s in a way where adding them together gives me some number, some unique number between 1, 2, 3, and 4. Now, I can't do that by just adding them together because that would give me numbers in the range from 2. It would be either 2, 3, or 4. So if I simply add them together, 1 and 2, or 2, 1 plus 2 and 2 plus 1, of course, is the same, and they would overlap. So I need to change them somehow. The way I change them is to subtract 1 and multiply 2 for the species and take the numbers as is. So this list of 1s and 2s gets converted into 0s and 2s. And my other list of 1s and 2s just stays as it is. Now, if I add randomly 1 and 2 to either 0 or 2, I get 1, 2, 3, and 4. So the result of this little arithmetic expression is a list of 2s and 1s and 4s and 3s. And these are integers that I can use to pick out elements from my color set. In the same way of subsetting that we've done previously many times before. So whenever a 2 appears in this vector, I will get this orange color, this bluish color. Whenever a 1 appears in this vector, I will get this bluish color, somewhat lighter blue, this one here. Whenever I get a 4, I get this reddish orange color. Whenever I get a 3, I get this somewhat lighter orange color. So this expression here now produces a vector. Well, I should define it first. Produces a vector like this. So these are my colors. One specific to every single element that I'm going to be using, and 200 of them overall. So now if I pass 200 colors to my plot instructions, I get a specific color for every single element. So let's try that. Plot x, y, col equals crab colors. Right? So every one of them has the color that I've assigned it here. Okay. Next task. So this vector of colors now defines specifically how I want to color my points. Of course, you can imagine whatever your problem is, you can create information that is encoded in color and apply it to all manners of different plot problems. Okay, now I create a vector of plotting characters, and I use the foreground, background, fill plotting characters, 21 and 24. We've looked at these yesterday. One is a circle, one is a triangle. And I work in basically the same way. I define a vector with two elements, 24 and 21. And I use the plotting characters here, and I can simply pick them out as integers. Sex already is a vector of ones and twos, and will thus retrieve plotting characters that correspond and encode the sex of the crabs that we're looking at here. If you've astutely observed what we did yesterday we relied on the fact that these are sorted 50 observations of one kind, then another 50 observations of a second kind, and so on. Of course, this is a brittle assumption. If normally your data is not as nicely organized, it's all over the place. But the way that we're doing this doesn't rely on that sorting anymore. It could be completely shuffled. We're taking the information directly from the actual factor values that we encounter in each row. Okay, we assign that to the crab plotting characters. And plotting character equals crab PCH. And now we have the circles and the triangles in the way that we want them. Now, we'd like to use a scale vector. And for this, we use the plotting parameter CEX. This is for character expansion. This defines the size with which a character is plotted. So if I plot all my characters here with a CEX of 0.7, they get really small. If I plot them with a character of 4, they get pretty large. So this is usable. If they get even larger, there's too much overlap. If they get even smaller, I can't see them anymore. So this takes a little bit of fidgeting and experimenting. What is the right size for the particular plot that you're trying to produce? So I assign the numbers that I use here to variables so I can change them easily in case I want to. And now all I need to do is to take the numbers that I find in the first principal component, these numbers here, or that's what their distribution looks like, somewhere from minus 30 to 30. Take these numbers and scale them into the range, linearly scale them into the range 0.4 by 4. And that's this a little bit convoluted expression. So the way the scaling and normalizing works is, at first, I subtract the minimum age from the age. The result of that is that now everything is shifted so that the smallest value is 0. Right? So I have this range of values here, and now the smallest value becomes 0. Same shape, but the smallest value is now 0. And I divide that by the difference between the maximum and the minimum in my range. So if I do that, of course, then my histogram changes in a way where it then goes from 0 to 1. Okay. Now, after I've scaled my numbers underlyingly from 0 to 1, so basically this is always the key step in rescaling data. same shape, but from 0 to 1. After that, I can work with it and rescale it into anything I want. For example, multiply it with the difference between my maximum and minimum scale, which is in this case 3.5, which will rescale this entire thing to go from 0 to 3.5, and then add S min to it, and this will shift all my numbers to go from 0.5 to 4, and that's exactly what I want. So executing this, gives me this vector of scales. And that's what it looks like, going from 0 to 0.5. And now this encodes the information about the scale that I want to use. Now, trying this plot again. So my color is crab colors. Now, actually, that's not what I really wanted. If I define colors for plotting characters 21 and 24, I define the color of the borders. But I'd like the color of the borders to remain black. The fill is called BG for the plotting characters. Plotting character is encoded in crab PCH, and CX is now in crab PCH. CX, the character expansion.
No, your variable should be crab CX. CX equals crab CX.
Thank you. Oh, what's my mistake here?
Two equal sides.
Everybody notice my typo? Column. I get an error in the expression column equals black. Comparison is possible only for atomic and list types. What do you do? What's the mistake? Everybody see the error? Okay, the error is I've used two equals characters. This is not an assignment. This is a comparison. So I need to put this back, and I get the expected results. So once again, if I say A equals 5, I can assign 5 to my value A. This is the assignment equals. If I say this here, this is a logical comparison. This asks whether this is true or not, and the result is true or false. So in this case, it is true and false. Because this error is frequently made, by convention, R uses this assignment operator. So do that in your scripts, use this assignment operator. Also by convention, however, parameters require the use of an equal sign. So this is a bit of an inconsistency. Whenever specifying parameters, we need an equal sign for the assignment of the parameter value. Everywhere else we use this assignment operator, which I think is quite readable and avoids exactly this kind of problem. Okay, now, yeah?
Can you make the font a little bigger?
Actually, no, because if I make it even bigger, I lose so much screen real estate that it becomes difficult to demonstrate the plots. They get too squished. So this is about all I can do. You have all the text on your own computer. Yeah? Okay. I've tried this out. I think yesterday when we went through two stages of zooming, it became very difficult. Perhaps after our forced evacuation. If you have difficulty reading the screen, and you're sitting in the back row, maybe you can swap with somebody who sits a little closer to the screen, or we can set it up that way.
Question.
Yes.
When you were putting it together, you had the value subtracted from the minimum to give it zero. And if you had used that, now subsequently you change that to 0.5 as a minimum, correct?
Yes.
Because if you had used the zero, you wouldn't see anything.
Exactly, because if I use a character expansion factor of zero, nothing gets shown.
So why didn't you just use something other than zero for the minimum to begin with? Like using
for what minimum?
Less than the minimum. The minimum was 0.4.
Oh, okay. I see. 0.3. I see. Okay. I could do this simply by shifting the minimum over here. Now, the way that I do this, normalization and scaling, and I think this is a sane way to do it, is I always take my data and I first linearly transform it into the range 0 to 1. After that, I rescale it to something else. So that's always my first step. You can save a few strokes and immediately roll all this difference and offset into one expression. You're absolutely right. Okay. So I'd like you to simply select and execute this function so that you have it available in your environment. We'll be using it for plotting a little later on. It should now appear in the functions here, plot crabs, and work in this way. Okay, to recap, because this is important, often when we plot, we would like to identify which elements correspond to which points. We can use encoding of categorical values, and we can use encoding of continuous variables or other discrete variables in color, in shape, in size, in order to make multidimensional relationships available. There are other strategies for even higher dimensional data that people use for plots. So two things that come to mind is that you can also plot pie charts in place of these points, and these pie charts can then have proportions of values that correspond to, you know, the 5 or 6 or 7 data dimensions that you might be interested in. I think this is a good approach, but of course it won't work very well if the number of data points are as large as this one. One other thing that I remember for displaying multidimensional data or encoding this kind of information on a plot is faces. So faces have many attributes. Whether eyes are open and closed, whether the face is wide or narrow, whether it's smiling or something else. So basically, you can encode the expression of a face with a number of parameters. And our visual system is extremely well-tuned to identify expressions in faces or little shifts and changes in faces. So what this approach does, it draws little cartoon faces while varying these characters, and you can then also identify these little cartoon faces that have similar expressions relatively easily, even on a cluttered plot, and thus make inferences about how similar particular data points are. I've never actually used this in my work. I always found it's kind of a, you know, neat, orthogonal, creative way to work with data. So in the sense of playing with data and trying to become intuitive of it, it may be a good approach. Here I'm just mentioning it. Good. Now, finally, let's go back to working with our data. We left off having calculated principal component analysis of a normalized version of gene expression data from the yeast cell cycle gene expression set. Now, if you remember, in the data file that we read, in originally in column one contained gene names, systematic gene names. And I'd like to pull that out again with this expression here and call them CHO genes to have the gene names available. I'd like to use them later on to identify a little better what these genes actually do. And I've created a little function, list genes, which uses cat and sprintf to print these genes in a more principled way. So if I simply extract them and use a header, I get them all in a line. With this function here, I get the actual index listed, and I get the actual gene name listed. So the way this works, cat is similar to print. But whereas print gives me the indices of the object that it's printing, and automatically a new line, cat doesn't do that. Cat simply puts characters to the screen and does nothing else. So if I want control over what I print out to the screen, I use cat. If I simply want some default formatted listing of the contents of my data objects, I use print. And what I cat here is the sprintf function. So I define a string. This is basically the template for what I want printed out. My string contains %d, which says this is a placeholder for an integer. And it contains %s, which is a placeholder for a string. And the d and the s are separated with a colon and a blank. And the string is terminated with a backslash n, which is a new line. So all in all, this gives me one per line, a number, and a string on each and every line. The number it should print is I, because I'm going through a loop here where I generate i's from 1 to the length of the vector that I'm giving it. And the string that it prints is the corresponding numbers pulled out of my CHO gene names. So for what this function essentially does then is, differently from head CHO genes, the equivalent for these genes would be list genes 1 to 6. That's what that looks like. So number 1 is this, number 2 is this, number 6 is this. I like this because if I give it some random numbers, what did I do wrong now? This function is wrong. Nice. Great error. Okay, do you see what it does? I've just told what I think it should do. But do you see what it does? So I give it a sample of numbers from 5 numbers taken from 1 to 237, these numbers here. And it prints my gene 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Why?
Because you don't pass in the vector, you pass in just 5 positions which you want.
Right. So I'm ignoring my contents of x. I'm just using my loop variable here. For I in one length x, print I and CHO genes I. And that, of course, is, depending on how long x is, simply the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. So there's a logical error in this function. It's syntactically correct, but it doesn't do the right thing. How do I need to fix it? What do I need to do instead?
Instead of CHO genes in square brackets, I should put x of i.
Absolutely correct. So instead of I need to use x of I. Okay? That means for the first loop iteration, I get my first element of my argument here. For my second loop iteration, I get the second element, and so on, and not just the literal numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this doesn't give me the number 1, but it gives me my first argument. Not the number 2, but my second argument. Do you understand this difference? The principle is basically the same principle that we use pulling specific colors and specific plotting shapes out of the sets of colors and the sets of plot shapes that we defined. We simply use a number to look into another object. So the number 125 isn't used as is, but it simply is used to point into an object and retrieve the information. We call that an index. This is why it's often used, why we often use I for it as an index. All right, now, if you make that change, so replace my code, my erroneous code, with x of I here and here, then the function should work as expected. If we give it 5 random numbers, now it gives me the row numbers and the actual contents of the genes. Okay, so this is what list genes is good for. All right, let's use this to study similar genes with similar expression profiles. So at first I prepare my plot here. By first plotting an empty frame for my principal component analysis along dimension 1 and dimension 2, which kind of spreads out my numbers here. And then I use the function text to print not the points, but the actual numbers. Because now I want to identify things. I want to understand what particular genes are. PCA tells me that they are similar. So this is my first view into real biology happening. We're not just doing maths now, we have biology. We say, well, these seem to have similar expression profiles. Similar expression profiles often mean co-regulation. Co-regulation usually means that they have some functional similarities. So now we can start discovering things in our data, functionally related genes. So from this, we could perhaps see that the gene in row 193 and 142 and 235 and 98 are kind of similar. So we select from this plot, and we define a selection. I call this selection 1. And I replot this with a different color. So my points get overwritten, and I confirm that what I've selected is what I wanted. I didn't make a typo in the selection. Now, then I use a function, matrix plot. And this is a very, very elegant way to look at high dimensional data. So this is also called a parallel coordinates plot. Every x-axis point in this corresponds to something in a column, and thus the parallel coordinates plot allows me to look at how the values, my expression values in this case, vary over time. And I get these expression profiles. Now there's a quirk in that. Parallel coordinates plot requires, I believe, the data to be in a column format. If I simply give it a vector, like this here. No, it's the other way around. It requires the data to be in a row format, and what I get from my data frame is the data in a column format. So before Matplot uses this, I have to transpose the data. A transpose of a matrix basically means I take all my rows and I change them into columns and vice versa. So the transpose of what I have here with 7 rows and 17 columns is a data object with 17 rows and 7 columns. And this is what Matplot requires as input. So all the time points in one column for one object. So if you do this Matplot and it doesn't look right and it doesn't have the right number of points and the points are all over the place and none of this makes sense, then you might have, you might need to transpose your matrix. This is the reason for this little T in here. So, but used in this way, we have these points and we have our genes. These are the genes we selected. Now, do they all look like that? Is that actually something significant? So I think these genes look like they have very similar expression profiles. Now, is that something that we'd expect simply from the structure of our data set? It might well be that, after all, we've selected genes that are either known or suspected to be involved somewhere in the cell cycle, and maybe everything in the cell cycle is at a resting state when we start, then is highly expressed as the cell cycle, the first cell cycle commences. So maybe this is nothing significant. So to find that out, we can select 10 random genes for comparison. So we generate a random selection in which we sample 10 numbers from 1 to 237 using the sample function. So these are my randomly chosen genes, and my random genes look like this. What does this tell you? So this is a computational control experiment that we've just done. What? How did that control turn out? What does the control tell you?
Random.
It is kind of random. And so this means that if I pick random genes from my data set, their expression profiles are random. They're not structured. They're kind of all over the place. There's a lot of variability in the data that I've used, in my actual source data. And I find that if I just pick random genes. So that's not what this previous plot of my PCA selected genes looked like. The PCA tells me they're similar, and indeed their expression profiles are obviously more similar than what I would expect from random chance. So my negative control told me that my actual experiment seems to have significant information. Okay, so let's do it. Make a different biplot and select some different genes. So now my first data set is in sky blue here. If I use principal components 1 and 3. So it's spread out differently. So these genes cluster only in principal components 1 and 2, and they don't cluster as well in 1 and 3. But I could look at a different data set that seems to cluster in this and then ask, well, how are these different? So for example, I can take this cluster here. 20, 227, 143, 128, 192, 75. And this is my cell 1. We get to that task in a moment. This is my cell 2. So how are they different? These are expression profiles. You all have a biological background. I show you these two expression profiles and ask, we have two groups of genes here. And we're looking at expression profiles during during a cell cycle. How are these gene expressions different?
Well, they generally follow the same pattern, but you can see that the brown
They generally follow the same pattern, but?
The brown ones are early expressions. So they start early, and they're downregulated early, and they start again.
Exactly. So the time course of the expression of this brown or firebrick colored cluster of genes is earlier. So these expression levels start earlier than those expression levels. What does that mean?
Well, from the way we normally interpret experiments like this, we have the same thing happening, but one thing happens earlier than the other. We might hypothesize that they are actually genetic regulatory interactions, that some master gene switches on these genes, and then maybe some of these genes are themselves transcription factors which cause the blue group of genes to be expressed. So by finding genes that have different time points of expression, we can then start trying to unravel the results of the experiment in terms of genetic regulatory elements or genetic regulatory networks. Now, do you know if that's actually the case? So we have our list of genes here. And our list of genes here. Do you know if any of this group are transcription factors that influence any of that group? I certainly don't. I don't know if there are any yeast experts in the group who recognize any of the systematic names. So what I'd like to do is to take you through a task where I have no idea how it will go. I haven't done this. It's not in the script. But I think it's a question that comes up at that point, and that's highly relevant for the kind of work that you do. I have these systematic names here. I'd like to know the common names. For example, I wonder whether any of these in group 2 are cyclins. And I'm too lazy to go into Wikipedia and look up every single one here. So I would like to take my list of gene names that I've done before and convert that into common names as a tool to be better able to annotate the data that I use here. So I don't know how to do that. I hope we'll find a way. Let's take this as a collaborative task. And you shout out ideas, and we'll try to see what they do and how we can make them work. I think SGD calls these the common names. Let's have a look. No, I'm not going to bias this. So, to recapitulate what we have, we have a vector of 237 strings which contain the systematic yeast names. What's our goal? What do we think we should be having?
Well, we want to find descriptive names for each gene.
Yeah. So our goal is to create a vector of 200,
37 standard names. In bioinformatics, ID conversion is the bane of our existence. It's really, really a nuisance. However, it goes without saying that without tools for ID conversion in bioinformatics, you can achieve nothing. Your collaborators will come up with their own quirky ways to name and label things, and if you want to find something in the NCBI databases or in the EBI databases, you will need the right identifier, and it will be painful to look it up. So I think this is an excellent opportunity to look into this topic. Okay, any suggestions? What do your searches produce? Ben, what would you do next?
Google it.
Google what? Systematic names. So we'll Google convert.
Are there any tables that have both columns and basically like a reference that has both columns?
I don't know. Did you find one?
No.
Okay.
So it would be good to find a source of a database that might have both sets of names. Swiss plots might be one.
Well,
bioconductor pack.
Now you said there's a table on UniProt. Is that one of the links here? Or how did you find that table?
Yeah, so scroll, it's right below yeast extract, right in the middle of your screen.
Yeast.txt UniProt?
And then you can download it as a text file. At the top left, it's downloaded.
Okay. Is that useful?
So it's linked with SwissProt. So if you work with both, it will bring out all the information about each protein.
These gene designations, as far as I can tell, are the standard names. These would be the systematic names. So we have corresponding systematic and standard names in the same table. Let's see if the one we were looking for is actually there. It is. And what we get here is three synonyms. And that looks like something that we could get to work rather quickly. And take that apart and quickly get the information that we need. So this here is a data source. What's the next thing we need to do? Lauren, what would you do next?
So do you have the data frame that you can just read it in?
It's right now it's a text file in my web browser. So thankfully, it's not HTML formatted. It's actually a text file. I don't need to scrape the text information out. I don't need to get rid of images or anything.
Yeah, you just need to find a way to get that information in your environment.
Right. So at first, I do what? Amit, create a file. Save it. Save file. Save page as. Format text, and I put this into REDA dimensions. Is that the right location? Yep, this is where I keep my stuff. Yeast.txt. All right. Great. Now what? Yeast.txt. Excellent. Okay, so in order to make my life easier, I'll just throw out all the header information first, because I don't want that. We'll have enough headache as it is. but we already know what part of the data we need. So the goal is to find this data here. There seem to be varying amounts of spaces in between here. But what we'll also need to be careful of is that there's spaces and semicolons over here. So this can be a nuisance. So is there any way that you think we ought to pre-process this so it becomes easier? What's easy to read? What have we done before? What kind of text file? Yeah.
Can you just replace use an expression to find all the spaces and replace them with tabs and then import the file as a tab separated?
That's one thing I could do. I could replace all these spaces here with tabs or with commas.
Could you just use the white spaces to separate
itself? Right, but I have variable numbers of white spaces here.
You want to save it as CSV?
Do I? CSV or TSV? Should we try that? Go for CSV as a canonical format that seems familiar to us. Okay, the one thing that I'm most worried about is the spaces with the semicolons here. If I simply break on spaces, then I would separate these two things here. But I shouldn't be doing that, because that will put my information into the wrong column. So the first thing that I'd like to do is to replace every occurrence of a semicolon space with simply a semicolon. So, edit, replace and find, semicolon space, and replace with a semicolon. There we go. Okay, so it goes to the bottom. It shows me, there's additional information here, which I also want to delete. So that seems to be reasonable. Now I have ranges of blanks here of different lengths, and I'd really just want a single blank. In every line. Can I do that? I don't know if I should be showing you all these terrible hacks, but in practice, this is very often how we get stuff done quickly. Of course, the ideal way would be to read every single line, line by line by line, and then write a proper regular expression which finds within the line the data that I'm actually looking for and then uses that. That is the proper way to do it. But since we're doing this only once, doing it in some quick and dirty way that we can do while we shut most of our brain off is probably a viable practical alternative. So what I end up doing in these cases often is I simply replace two blanks with one blank. And do that again. And do that again. And drink some coffee. And scratch my tummy. And do it over again. And at some point, there's nothing more to replace. So now I have a data set where every single line has a blank and these elements with multiple entries here are separated with a semicolon. Now I can do one more thing and actually separate all my single blanks, replace all my single blanks with a comma. And then file save as yeast.csv. Nice. Okay, what do I do next? I have a CSV file. Now I need to read my CSV file. Right?
Yeah, read.csv.
Yeah. If I do that, then the whole thing will be dumped on my screen. So I'll also assign it. Let's just call it CSV raw is read.csv of my file name.
Yeast.csv.
And what about header? Header equals false because I deleted that. Anything else? Separation comma is correct by default. I could have put in explicitly a separation by blank here at that point. Quote and decimal and fill and so on, all this is irrelevant. Strings as factors is false. I want my strings as strings. So let's see what that does. Oops. It does something. It's syntactically correct. Let's see whether it's also meaningful. Column 1 is my systematic gene name. Column 1 is my standard gene name. Column 2 is my systematic gene name. Except that in some cases, my column 1 still needs to be processed a little bit. We can, you know, have opinions on whether we should, which one of the several synonyms that are listed here we should be using, but for simplicity, we'll just use the first one if that comes up. But we'll get to that in a moment. Okay, so far so good. Now let's test this. Can we actually pull something out? So if we have if we have a string like YAL40C, how do we find the corresponding row in our CSV raw? How do we actually find our genes? So this is one of these pesky filtering expressions that you probably need at this point. Right, so I think we'd want the row in our CSV raw file that contains this string in column 2. Can somebody tell me what to type? Lauren, what would you type?
Sorry, what?
What would you type to find the row that contains this string in column 2?
Column
draw.
Sorry,
yeah.
And then I would open brackets.
Yep.
And I want the row that has that in column two, so I would use CSV raw again. And then I would open brackets so that it goes to column two, and then so comma two. And then I would go outside brackets, yeah, and then it equal.
Right now I do. Everybody clear on what that does? So this expression here hopefully gives me 6,727 falses and one true. And this one true should point to the correct row. And why does it not? It does not because it's not in there. And why is it not in there? Why does it not find my string? We've been searching all rows in that column to ask whether that string is present. But apparently my string while 040C is not in my table here. Uppercase! Exactly. So do you notice this difference? It does make a difference. Okay, so since they're all lowercase in where we come from, we have to say something like to upper before we do our comparison. Okay, now we have this problem here, that our column 1 contains more than one item. So basically, I tell it, use V1 here, just for aesthetics, because I've been harping on that a lot, not using magic numbers, but proper column identifiers. I'll change this to V2. Really doesn't matter in this case. So I'm assigning this. So now I have this string. What I want, however, is just this part. Any ideas? How do I process this string to get only the first part?
Now, everybody who was here for the first day should be waving their hands all over the place now, because this is something we've done.
Lots. We use the function, Ben, what function would you use?
To grab just the first element?
Yeah.
Use split string?
Yeah, we split the string. We use strsplit. Strsplit. And we split on a semicolon. So we get a list with one element, which contains a vector of three elements, of which the first element is what we need. Now we can use a shorthand for that. First element of the list
and the first element of that vector. I could also have used unlist and then pulled out the first element of my vector or something similar. So this is this one element, CLN3. Okay. Now, let's make this into a function. Let's make it into a function that loops over whatever input we give it, which is probably formatted like our CHO genes, i.e. a list of a vector of individual systematic genes. And for each systematic gene, it retrieves the standard name. So let's make a small subset of our first vector, of our CHO genes vector, simply to test out what we're doing here. So something like test CHO genes sample 1 to 237 for, say, 5 elements. So this vector here, we'll use that as a test. Now, I need something that goes over these elements one by one and then gives me that result. And I think all the components are there, but we still need to pull it together. So we'll write a little loop that loops over test and works what we need to do. What should that loop look like? In general, a for loop looks like for, usually we call it I in something something, do something. So the first question is, what should this be? What is the range that my I should go over? What's the first value that I should have? The first value that we use in our loop is 1. What's the last value that we should use?
The length of whatever we want to loop over.
The length of whatever we want to loop over. So in this case, it's 5. But in the next case, it's not going to be 5, so it's going to be something else. What's the length of our vector? And in this case, it is our vector test. Is that correct? Yes, this is 5. So our loop should now be generating numbers I, 1, and 5. Does it? Okay. Sanity test. Everything works as expected. But now I need to use that I to access my gene names. So how do I do that? We've done something very similar previously for our list genes function. How do I specify the first element of my vector test? If I want only the first element, what do I have to write? Only the first element of test. So test is a vector of 5 elements. To get the first element, I type test, square bracket, 1. Right? Sorry. The second element, test 2. The fifth element, test 5. Okay, so since I don't want to type this by hand, I use my variable I here. Every iteration of the loop then gives me one of these elements. So my first, my second, my third, my fourth, my fifth element here. So in this way, inside my loop, I now successively, for every iteration of my loop, I have one of the gene names that I'm interested in available, and that is test I. So let's assign it to make things very explicit. So we assign it to the variable cyst. Now we need to use the value of cyst to extract from our vector whatever we have up here. So, presumably, we do something very similar to this here. We just take this string and say standard is CSV raw, where we select from column 2, 2 upper of what we've just had here, and use that to pull out the element in column 1. Actually, to confirm that this is true, I'll print column 2, the column 2 value as well. Oh, sorry. I meant to print this, not assign it. Okay, so I get my five elements. For the first one, I get this string here. For the second one, I get this string. For the third one, I get MCM3. There is only one MET28, MRPS12. And so on. Nice. Okay. So let's assign this on every iteration. And then do this here. So string split on standard. Right now I'm just, again, printing this out. So these are my translated standard gene names. Now what do I need to do next?
I suspend that's about all to get from the CSV.
Except that I'm only printing them. So instead of printing them, I still need to assign them somewhere and store them in an output vector. So in order to do that, I will make an output vector that I initialize to simply empty elements. So I will call this vector cho standard, and I will initialize it to the same number of elements that I have in my test vector. So there are there's essentially three expressions to build empty vectors like that. One is character, which builds an empty character vector. One is integer and or numeric, and one is logical. So this is simply an empty vector, 5 instances of an empty string. But since this vector now exists, I can assign values into the slots of this vector here. So instead of printing this, I shall assign it and I shall assign what I've read from the ith position of my vector test into the ith position of my vector standard. So I get this victory. Now, we could write a function to do this. But of course, we can, since we only want to do this once, we can also do this directly. And simply instead of test, we use CHO genes. Same thing. So CHO genes here. CHO genes here. At first, this is a vector of 237 empty strings. And now I iterate over this position by position, munge it as acquired. And something didn't work. I did something wrong. Oh. I also, of course, need to replace this here. Okay. So, for the length of the elements of CHO genes, build me an empty vector. Then, for the first to the last of these genes, I pick out the string that I'm interested in, call it cyst. I convert that to uppercase. I pull out the element in the first column that has this name. I assign that to standard. I split it up along semicolons, if any. I take the first element of that split and the first element of that result and assign that into the same position of my vector CHO standard. So what did I get? Subscript out of bounds. So this typically means that something went wrong with my assumptions on the input. So let's see what the assumptions are here. It probably means I'm trying to access a first element where there is no first element. So this is in line 18 of my output. Yeah, CSV wrong. That's what I was looking for. Oh no, this is not line 18 of CSV raw. This is line 18 of CHO genes. This one here, and where does it appear? Good. This is our little quick and dirty conversion. Trying out things, playing with things, breaking things, looking at the error, figuring out what the errors means, trying things differently until we arrive at the solution that we need. Now, we have chose genes for the systematic gene names and chose standard for the standard gene names. And we can now go back . Remember, we had this list genes function, which prints the genes, but it doesn't yet print the standard gene names. So we'll modify our function because we have this new vector here. And we'll add a second placeholder for a string. And we'll add a second little expression that pulls out the string, which goes into this placeholder position from the list of gene standard names. Then we redefine the function. I leave that up for a moment. Do you see how to modify this? I add a second placeholder and to basically get something into that spot for the second placeholder, I add a second expression, this one here. It works just in the same way as the one before, but it pulls out the character strings from our standard names. And now we get this. I'm not going to make the change that all lines them up nicely into columns. You could either use tabs or, tabs are so simple that I'll just change it with tabs. Okay, instead of the blanks here, we'll just write a backslash t. Backslash t is a tab. There are also ways to, There are also ways to print these things within the printf command in a left-adjusted way, in a right-adjusted way, with a fixed width, to print floating-point numbers with a fixed number of numbers preceding the decimal point and numbers following the decimal point, to print integers with leading zeros or not leading zeros, right or left aligned, whatever. This is all very easy to install. You'll just need to look up a documentation for SprintF formatting commands. And this is a very flexible way to quickly produce tabular output of any sort. Okay, so this was our little digression of more easily being able to identify. And the reason we were looking at this, if you remember, was we were wondering what these red genes do and if any of them are famous transcription factors. I'm not a yeast geneticist at all, but CDC45, isn't that one of these cyclins? Anybody remember their third year molecular genetics course? Cell cycle? I'm excused. None of this was known when I took my molecular genetics courses. So I believe, yes, that's actually true. I think this is one of the key regulators of the cell cycle. I might be wrong. I think RAD27 is also a checkpoint gene. So of course, within the cell cycle, all manners of checkpoint regulation gets activated or not. Okay. So this confirms our suspicion that our simple, completely mathematical and otherwise biology agnostic procedure of principal component analysis is able to discover significant biology in our data set. Not quite off the bat, and the first thing we get from the principal component analysis is a scree plot, i.e. the loadings of the individual components, which ones are more or less important. That really doesn't tell us a whole lot at all. But we can get it there. We can use this to distinguish genes, and we can use it to identify and ultimately to cluster genes that are similar to each other. Now, one thing we briefly discussed yesterday was the question, well, what are these principal components? How do we interpret them? And we had to conclude that's hard to say. Any number of dimensions along which we look at our data, and in this case, these are 17 dimensions, i.e. the 17 different time points, any number of dimensions may contribute in some way to the first, second, and the third principal component. And it's not easy to say what the first principal component looks at. So what I'm going to do is basically discuss with you an alternative approach of things that you can interpret. And this is kind of similar to things we would do in factor analysis. Factor analysis is an alternative approach for dimension reduction where you try to come with preconceived notions of what factors are and pull them out of your high-dimensional data set. In principle, we can, for example, define three simple models and then ask to what degree do our observed gene expression profiles a long time correspond to any of these models. So these simple models, for example, might be to use a half sine or a cosine wave, a single sine wave, and two sine waves, kind of looking like this. And then simply taking that as an idealized model and calculating Pearson correlation coefficients. That will tell us to what degree does an observed profile correlate with an idealized profile that I define to be a model. So let's generate such profiles. The profile has to have 17 components, 17 elements. So I initialize this simply with the number 1 to 17, and then I calculate cosine and sine functions that are appropriately scaled from 1 to 17 to give me the following three profiles. Oops, none of this works if I don't do all of it. Here we go. So these are three models that we can apply. So the one that presumably corresponds the most to our actually observed data is the green one, because the cell cycle data set contains two cell divisions. So we would expect a cyclically varying gene to be expressed with something that correlates like this here. The red curve could approximately correspond to genes whose expression simply dies over the time course of the experiment. So controls, perhaps, things that don't like the experimental conditions. The black one would be cells that are highly expressed in the first cycle and then die out over the second cycle, something like that. Any number of biological hypotheses, as long as you can assign it to 17 numbers that correspond to some profile, can be installed as a model like this. So you can come up with anything that you're interested in. Now, instead of calculating the coefficients of the principal components, we simply create empty vectors at first, and then calculate the coefficient of correlation for our profile with the data set. So we pull out for all the data here, we pull out the individual elements and then calculate the coefficient of correlation. So this is what that looks like for a plot of one sine wave against two sine wave correlations. So it looks very similar to our principal component plot, at least in its general and overall structure. But now this has the advantage that I can interpret the dimensions. So if I look at this here, the genes over on this side have a high coefficient of correlation with the double sine wave. The genes over on this side have a high negative correlation with my double sine wave. So these are correlated with my double sine wave. These are anti-correlated with my double sine wave. The genes here are correlated with my full sine wave. The genes down here are anti-correlated with the full one. Or if I use the half correlation, these genes here are the ones that kind of die out over the course of the experiment. And these, all these here don't die out. And these genes down here seem to increase in expression over the course of my experiment because they're anti-correlated with my model. So the advantage of looking at models like that is that you can immediately interpret the plots that you get, which you can't necessarily do in principal component analysis. Principal component analysis only tells you we have genes here that are similar, and you don't yet know why they're similar. Genes that I find in these model-based correlations, that I can immediately interpret. So if I have a biological hypothesis, I can detect the biological hypothesis. And then I can start, for example, selecting groups of genes that correspond to two clusters here, here, and up here. And I'm just outlining where these are here. So the first selection one is this cluster of genes. The second selection two is this cluster of genes. And the third selection three is this cluster of genes. Now, if I plot these, their actual time courses, I get this. So the first set of genes, predictably, is correlated with my first model. These are the genes that cyclically vary along the time course of the experiment. These are anti-correlated. So these are low when it begins, and they are highly expressed in the intermediate stages. And these ones here, remember, they came from the middle of the correlation with the sine wave, i.e., they're not well correlated with it, but they're high in their correlation with the single cosine function. So this means they kind of drop off over time. These genes here are the ones that we simply lose over the time course of the experiment. So these are cell cycle specific genes here, and maybe something like environmental responders over there. So for exploratory data analysis, this is a complementary and in some way orthogonal approach. What we've done before is simply discovering structure in our data where we had no idea of what that structure might be. We were just pulling out things that are similar and then leaving it to our biological imagination and interpretation to note that similar genes have probably some biological reason, some biological relationship why they are similar. And in this case, we come in with a hypothesis of what our data would look like under ideal conditions, and we confirm or disprove our hypothesis that genes like this actually exist. Now, I'd like you to show you an alternative approach, which kind of has similar results, and once again, is completely agnostic about what the meaning of our data is, but it can be applied to high-dimensional data, and it has surprisingly good results to discover structure in high-dimensional data. And this is T-stochastic neighbor embedding. This is an approach originally developed by Geoff Hinton at U of T's Department of Computer Science. And I've put you the Wikipedia link where it's briefly described. It's not too mathematical. Certainly do have a look. Essentially what happens here is that we have a high dimensional distribution of points, and we come up with a probability function that would describe this high dimensional distribution. And then we map this high-dimensional distribution into a two-dimensional or perhaps three-dimensional space. This is our plotting space. So we take a high-dimensional distribution, but we'd like to plot them in 2D space because that's something we can easily see. So we come up with a probability distribution that describes points in a 2D space, and we try to adjust it such that the difference between the two probability distributions is small. This kind of mapping has the property that things that are close together in high-dimensional space are close together in low-dimensional space. I.e., if points are similar because they are somewhere in a similar element of space in our 17-dimensional time set, they will also end up to be similar in our two-dimensional map plot. Now, once again, the details of what this mapping function is can probably not be interpreted in any reasonable way. So it's like principal component analysis, a way to simply discover structure but not to interpret this kind of structure. But, well, I'll just show you how it works. There's a package from CRAN, TSNE, which you can download and install. It has documentation, and it works in the following way. To run TSNE, you give it data to work on in a column format. In the crabs example, this is simply our crabs data. There's something called perplexity, which essentially in this context means how many neighbors do we want to it. Data plot, so whether the plot is going to be compact or not. There's a maximum number of iteration. This is a heuristic algorithm. It basically tries many, many, many different combinations and tries to improve its solutions as it goes along. So by default, maximum number of iterations is 5,000. And these iterations are split into epochs. In every epoch, it tries 100 times to improve its result, and then it briefly prints its output to reconsider what it should be doing. And as part of this, we can define a callback function. A callback function in this case is simply a function that is used to display the data. It doesn't need to only display the data. It could also dump the results or do some calculations or whatever. But in this case, the callback function that I define is simply a plot function. And the plot function is a function of the data in two dimensions, x1, x column 1, and x column 2, where I use my plot crabs function that I've previously written. So this is where this function comes in very, very handily. So rolling this together, we define this function here. And give the plot window some space. Set the seed to a number to make it reproducible, and run TSNE. So now the function is trying to optimize the segregation in a way so that similar points in 17-dimensional space remain similar points in 2-dimensional space. Note that TSNE knows nothing about orange and blue. This is not part of its data. If this segregation appears in 2D space, it is only because it was also apparent in 17-dimensional space. And note that TSNE is not bothered at all by the confounding factor of age that PCA had such trouble with initially. It basically, running with default parameters out of the box, is able to distinguish the structure in the data and display it in a meaningful way. And given that, you know, PCA out of the box actually didn't work on the crabs data, I think this is a very nice result. Remember, since our principal components were dominated by the confounding factor of age or overall size of the crabs, plotting PCH1 against PCH2 gave us nothing. So we basically needed something, some way to plot different principal components to figure out what we actually wanted. Now, TSNE doesn't need any of that. It's just able to retain the structure and display it here. So for association discovery or data discovery or similarity discovery in high-dimensional data, this seems to be a surprisingly effective, simple way to structure your data and to display it. One of the applications, I've mentioned this here, is a flow cytometry exploration tool, because you have high-dimensional data as well there. And for example, we've seen the clustering structure in the graft versus host disease experiment. TSNE would probably be able to pick out these clusters and identify them. So we can apply the same thing to the cell cycle data. And now I'll do this with a slightly different function. I pick two selections, not the same selections which I had before, but simply selections for which correlation 2 is greater than 0.77 and correlation 2 is less than minus 0.6. There's a bit of overlap here. So I get a small set of positive correlations and a larger set of negative correlations. And well, these are the very similar, the positive and the negative correlations here. because when I run my TSNE function now, I'm going to write a plot function which specifically plots these data points into the cloud of points which we otherwise have available. So in this way, I have a little bit of prior knowledge. I have prior knowledge that my positive correlations are these red data points, and my negative correlations with the model are these blue data points. Now, if TSNE works correctly, if TSNE works in the way that I naively would expect it, I would expect these data points to be somehow cohesive. They're cohesive in 17-dimensional space, they're very similar, and I would expect them to remain clustered together in 2-dimensional space. Well, maybe not completely, because after all, some of these are kind of similar. So maybe the cohesion is stronger for the red ones than for the blue ones, but we'll see what happens. So my callback function here, my plot function, is plot an empty frame add the points for the red and the blue selection, or firebrick and turquoise. Is that the right way to pronounce it? Turquoise? 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 And use the text function to plot the numbers for all the other columns. So this is my plot function. Again, it's a customized plot function for every instance. So there we go. The individual epochs take a little longer because there's more data to process. And it's exploring space and moving around. Okay, there we are, 2,000 iterations. So, this is partially true, at least for the positive correlation. My agnostic mapping in directly from the high-dimensional space into the two-dimensional space keeps points well together. For the ones with the negative correlation, that's not as clear. Perhaps that they are all related is somewhat of an overstatement. There appear to be other points that are more similar to these three, and this probably 112 seems to be a bit of an outlier to begin with. But now I can start generating hypotheses about my data and testing them by looking at the individual expression profiles, which I find around here. Now, for example, if I pick a cluster of genes in the vicinity of the originally selected values, so this is my selection 3, which is around these here. So in 17-dimensional space, there seems to be a cluster up here, and this cluster seems to contain genes like number 4, 192, 200, and so on. I can select them out here and then ask, well, is that true? Is the expression really in fact similar? And lo and behold, there it is. So in this way, again, I can also use TSNE like I used the other methods before to discover correlations and similarities. Other correlations and similarities. Now, if we take this list of genes here and plot that back on our model correlation plot, where would they lie? Presumably, they would cluster very closely with this core of 4 genes, which I defined. Here they are. Oops. Other way around. Nonsense, what am I doing here? This way. So these were my 4 original genes that I defined in the TSNE class, that I defined, and these are the similar genes with that TSNE identifies as being similar in 17-dimensional space, and here plotted on correlations of a half sine wave or a half cosine wave and two sine waves. So you see that there's a certain convergence there. In whatever way I look at the data, if I do this correctly, similar expression profiles or similar data sets are going to end up with similar analysis. And I've shown you essentially three different strategies of exploratory data analysis to be able to discover this. At home for self-study, and in order to consolidate what we've done here, you could ask, where does this two-cycle sine wave function itself end up if we put it into the data set? So the way that you would do that is you would add a row to the original expression data that contains the values for your model. And then the index of that row is something that you could use for plotting the coordinates of a somewhat colored circle. And in this way, you can track the relationship of your models with this high-dimensional to low-dimensional mapping and learn more about how your data set is structured. Okay. And that essentially concludes our little foray into dimension reduction. And I think it also essentially sets up in an ideal way the kind of questions that we would like to ask with clustering. Because you see that these data sets have intriguing structure, and now one question is, well, can we take an algorithm that simply finds all of these substructures and puts our data into categories where nothing is left unannotated? So we're not just cherry-picking here, we're trying to identify all of the structure of our data, all of the subpopulations that we potentially find. So this is the topic of clustering, which we'll turn to in a moment. Let me just mention this here very briefly, because it's a very useful thing. Shuffling data. We can use sample for that. So let's say we have a vector that contains the first six lowercase letters of the alphabet. A, B, C, D, E, and F. Now, if we simply use sample on that, by default, we get the same number of elements as that vector in a random order without replacement. So using sample in this way actually gives us a permutation of our data. So if we apply this permutation of data to every single row, to every single time point, then there should be no remaining correlations. And the positive control is then to ask, well, if we do that, what does our correlation analysis do? Will we find something that, or lots of things that look like they have correlations? If we do, that might put our whole approach into question. And we might then say, well, you know, if the time points are just all over the place, basically due to the nature of our analysis and perhaps the number of tests that we're doing and the potential for statistical fluctuations, we will get things that look like they have information. We will get things that look like they systematically decay or that they have an exponential curve or a sine wave or something beneath that underlying, while in fact it is just a result of the limited number of possibilities, and random chance has to pick among that limited number. So that's always a good and useful control to do using permuted data to make sure that the results that you get are actually different from randomness. We'll take a 5-minute break.